grace, mercy, and peace has been given unto each and every one of us from God, our loving Father, through His Son, our living Lord and Savior, in whose name we are together today as your people of God. Amen. It's a magnificent time to be together. We were together last Sunday to celebrate the birth of the Son of God and to celebrate the birth of the Savior of the world. And it truly was a magnificent time. You know, it's the only time in history that history stopped and time has started over. We number years up to the time of Christ, and today we number years after the time of Christ. Never before in history has anyone or any event or any single act impacted the world the way in which the birth of Jesus Christ has happened. There's a song that we're all familiar with called The 12 Days of Christmas. And many people misunderstand this song. Some have even tried to say it's a Christian song, that all the symbols are Christian symbols, and I think that falls apart when you really look at it pretty thoroughly. But it is a song that speaks of the event. The 12 days of Christmas are from when to when? From the birth of Christ to the appearance of what we call a Christmas, when the three wise men came with their kids to celebrate the birth. 12 days. But what the song does do for us when we look at that song is it asks us to think of this remarkable event from the time that God came to be one of us to the time that the wise men brought their gift to represent the relationship that we would have with God from that time on. There is a tradition within the early Christian family that 12 days period. The gifts were not to each other. The gifts were the gifts that they received the Son of God. So we are now 6 days after the birth of Christ, and I ask you, in the past 6 days, what gifts have you brought to your table? And I'm not going to ask for a show of hands or a show of volunteers, but think of all the things you could have brought: ourselves, our heart, our trust, our confidence, our commitment, our pledge, our commitment to share all that we have with Him, because all that we have comes from Him. Our commitment to worship Him, to praise Him, our commitment to share with others what He means to us. And the list goes on and on and on and on. And I ask you to look at your life and say, what has been your gift to God in the past? And we can't change it. But now the question becomes, what will be my gift to my Savior the next 6 days? Next Sunday will be the Sunday of the Epiphany. That is the celebration of the wise men coming with their gifts and seeing the child of God and seeing their Savior and working and praising with the light of the Lord. Next Sunday. So between now and next Sunday, what gift will you commit? Are you give? Are you pledge? Are you promise to your God? But you notice the songs in the shape of the Christmas tree. The Christmas tree, as much as many things in our Christian existence, the original evergreen tree in Europe was a pagan symbol of the pagan worshiping community. But Luther believed, as God says, all things become new in Jesus Christ. And Luther said we can take this pagan image and we can make it our own by adding light to it, because Christ is the light of the world. And so the Christian Christmas tree is always adorned with light and is adorned with decorations and symbols of the significant and important things in the lives of the world. As a way of saying back to God, it's a three point. Everything goes back to God. It is a reminder that it is from God above who sent His Son that we celebrate on this day, and how will that affect the lives of you and I live? Happy New Year. That's what we're going to talk about today. We've got 13 hours to bid farewell. And when we look back over the year, you know, there are two groups of people. There are those that can count the challenges of 2017, and there are those who will count the blessings of 2017. And for each and for every one of us, there have been hard. think the people that are healthier and happier and get it. So Bill Parcells is not my favorite person. I did like him as a coach. I did like him because he used that phrase, he gets it, he doesn't get it. And when he said he gets it, that guy's playing something. He said he doesn't get it, that guy's gone. And aren't we lucky that God didn't do that with us? Because there are many times we don't get it. But if we look back over 2017, sure, we recognize the challenges and say, hopefully I grew through those challenges. I'm a better person now because I went through that. Because there's so many blessings that are part of every day of our lives that we forget about and we fail to remember the goodness and the blessings thereof. You know, growing up and playing sports way into my middle adult life, I actually played fast pitch softball until I was 6 years old and finally had to give it up. I decided when I looked around, there's enough of 20-year-olds around me, and they're all looking at me saying, I hope he dies after the game, not during the game. I decided it was time to give it up. But you look at all the good things, and how many times do we fail to, when we get up in the morning and say, thank you, God, for the peace of mind. Thank you, God, that I woke this morning. Thank you, God, for my health. We normally don't even think about our health until we're sick. Then we ask God, why me? You know? And maybe we ought to be asking God, you know, why not all the time? Why am I not sick all the time? That's what I really deserve. But we look back on the year and we say to 17, dear God, thank you for the opportunity to grow through these challenges, but dear God, thank you even more for these blessings and rich goodness that you brought into my life. We read here from Isaiah, I says, do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. And what is God saying? In our car, we have a rearview mirror only to check what's behind, but you don't drive going in the rearview mirror, do you? Eyes on the road. The rearview mirror, you just check to see what's coming up behind you. Or if it's clear to change lanes or make turns, whatever it takes to be. But yet, I know so many people that live their life in the rearview mirror instead of through the clear windshield. And God is saying this as we march forward to not focus on the rearview mirror. That's exactly what he said here to the prophet Isaiah. And where does it lead? What's next? That's right. Wow. May all the blessings of the Lord be yours in abundance. That's what God wants. That's what God's word says. It's another year, another opportunity, another blessing. You know, God created us with a finite mind. Yeah, I remember in advanced calculus trying to get a mathematical formula for the thing we call infinity. So how do you define infinity? Our minds can't conceive it. We accept it, but we don't understand it because we live in a world, there's an end to everything. Remember the early world thought the world was flat, and then if you got in a ship, went far enough, you'd fall off the earth, and you'd go somewhere else. You know, we have these finite minds. It's difficult for us to believe what is this thing we call eternity. And yet in the song we just sung, we sung how magnificent it is that through Jesus Christ we have the promise of eternity, not just another year. But God came into the world to change us, to forget the old and to move forward to the new. God knew that we would need in the life that we live fresh start. You have a bad day, you go to sleep, you wake up the next morning, it's a fresh start. We work for 365, 366 days, and God says it's a time for a fresh start. Fresh start. You know, the first 6 years of my school life, I went to six different schools in 6 years. And I grew up with this belief, moving's good. You know, you get a clean start, you get a new place. Your bedroom, you put it all together, everything is in its place. We didn't have spring cleaning, we had spring moving. Yeah. And we knew it was coming, you kind of got used to it. And then we went to San Antonio for the first 3 years that we lived in San Antonio, like 40 years school. Because we moved, or because we, you know, completed elementary. And every time I felt that joy and no baggage, there's no bad memories, there's no hurt, there's no sorrow. Everything is pure. And the night when that clock gets 12, the ball falls, the time is square, it'll be a new minute, a new year, filled with new opportunities. And where do we go from here? We're going to start moving pretty quickly. Faith tells me that no matter what lies ahead of me, God is already there. Think about that. You know, we have anxiety about what tomorrow will bring. Why? God's already in tomorrow. And God has promised He would never take us to a place that He wouldn't be with us. So why are we nervous? Why are we anxious next year? But with every new year comes what? New year says, I've got to share a couple of them. Look at the list up there. Have you ever promised yourself any of those? No? All of them, yeah. Let's go to the next slide. You ever promised any of these? Drink less, exercise more, you know, lose weight. How do we talk about lose weight? Why don't we just say get fit? Okay? Somehow that sounds better. Okay? But we look at all these things we promise ourselves. You know, eat healthy. Anybody tell me what that is? Eating less. Michael, did you have to go there? Yeah. Come on. My dad had a little sign that hung right above the dining room table that said, everything I like is either illegal, immoral, or bad. Everything that's good and healthy and reasonable and rational, I don't like. Well, that's our nature. But we make these promises to ourselves. But Irma Bombeck said the good thing about making New Year's resolutions is you only have to do it for a month, because then Lent comes and you're free from all those promises. You are forgiven. So where do we go from here? You see this little cartoon. Can you read it? It might be a little bit hard to read, but I don't know if you're familiar with Agnes and Phil, but Phil on the left says, what exactly is a New Year's resolution? And Agnes says, it's a to-do list for the first week in January. Okay? And that is what it is. That is what it is. But what we have to realize, or the important thing for us to realize, is what it really is to realize that there's an old life that we will leave behind. We'll carry with us our traditions. We'll carry with us our memories. But we no longer focus our energies on yesterday. We look just like we do when we're traveling. We see that sign. Jill this morning as we're driving down, sees the sign. Turn right, go to Athens. She says, go to Athens? So we go this way every time. Athens is just the other side of Gunville City. The sign says Athens. But there's a little bit of excitement there. It's not where we've been, where we've come from. It's where we're going. Irma Bombeck said her New Year's resolution, she had four of them. And I love her. Not a biblical theologian, but I love her wisdom. She says, I will not go to any doctor who's planted his office of death. She says, I'm going to try to follow my husband's suggestion to put a little excitement into my life by living within our budget. I'm going to apply for a hardship scholarship to Weight Watchers. I will never loan my car to anyone I have given birth to. And if you've had the experience, I would encourage you never try to keep your wife on the track. Those are the things we do. But what's your New Year's resolution? What is it? And I'm not talking in the sense of the earthly, worldly concept. I'm talking about what is your resolution with God? How is 2018 going to be different from 2017 or any other time? Have you thought about ever pledging to God, God, I will give you more than I've given in the past. I will give you more of my time. I will be more faithful in worship. I'll be more faithful in Bible study. I'll be more faithful in serving the people of my community. I'll be more faithful in letting my friends know how much I love you, because I know how much you love me. And let me keep on going. So I encourage you. So lose weight, work harder, and all those things. We are who we are. We're not going to make a lot of changes. We're just not going to. But we can look at our spiritual life and our relationship with God, and we can say, just like we should say to our spouse, I want to do everything I can to make our relationship better, to make it all good. I will focus on those things that will make our relationship better. First with God, and then second with the people that God loves. God makes all things good. Some of the finest Christians I know are people that are adults in their adult years before they get saved. And it became so significant and so vital and so that they almost overcommit all through the instead of turning other parts of their life. But they understood the value of living without Christ and then with Christ, you see the dramatic difference. For many of us, we've always been Christian. We were born Christian. We were baptized Christian. We were raised Christian by Christian parents. We don't have that memory of what it was like to live with no hope and to live with the sustaining guilt of the lives that we lived and the choices that we made. And we didn't have hope of it. Well, God makes all things new. The pagan green evergreen in Germany became the symbol of Christianity and faith in the world. In our hearts and souls, He can take the wicked thoughts of our hearts, the evil doings of our minds, and He can mold that and change it and make it into something magnificent and beautiful and pure and make us a blessing to others. My prayer every day, dear God, may I be a blessing to everyone who has loved. A new day, a new year. Thank you, God. Fresh start. Always good. When's your best day at work normally? First day. You go to a new job, you're excited, you got a raise, you got a new title, you got a new office, you got a new parking spot. Wow.